The following presentation is part of the Technology and the Corporation Conference Series, sponsored by MIT's Industrial Liaison Program.
It's great to be here. Thanks to everybody for coming. And we have a very high-powered panel, except me, of course, to discuss issues of challenges and opportunities in manufacturing. And really, from what I understand, everybody's going to talk about manufacturing innovation. So very much complementing what Rod Brooks talked about. So the participants in the panel are all going to bring very different but valuable perspectives here. So I have, in this particular order, which is the order in which the panel is going to speak, we have David Hardt from our own MIT and Narendra Mulani from Accenture, Jim Breen from Johnson & Johnson, and Bill Roof from GE. I'm going to start with a few sort of comments framing the discussion, and then we'll go in this particular order, and then I'll also participate at the end as the final panelists. So I think Rod's talk framed the questions very nicely, but I think the issue of manufacturing and manufacturing innovation is really central at the moment. The US has just been taken over, or is about to be taken over, depending on how you look at it, as the number one merchandise manufacturer exporter in the world by China. And of course, we are continuing a trend in which employment and also value added, to some degree, are shifting away from manufacturing to non-manufacturing. The healthcare sector will soon probably take over manufacturing in terms of its importance in the economy. But despite the sort of the decline in manufacturing that comes from these secular changes and from outsourcing and offshoring and international trade, as some tasks shift from the United States to other countries where they can be performed more cheaply, and with the advances in information technology and transportation technology, can be guided and transported cheaply. We still have manufacturing as a central part of the economy. We talk of the healthcare sector, for example, but the healthcare sector very crucially depends on manufacturing innovations, and manufacturing sector, as we'll talk, is a nexus of both innovation and also organizational innovations in the economy as a whole. And we are also at a turning point, not only because the US is being eclipsed as the number one manufacturer in the world, but also because the way that we are approaching manufacturing is changing very much. It's changing not as a result of software and IT innovations only, but also because the nature, business organization, the network structure of innovation in manufacturing, both as it relates to the supply chain and also as it relates to its customers, is changing very much. And this has both important implications for corporate strategy and overall policy in the United States as we'll move into the 21st century, and perhaps we can hope for an equally innovative but differently organized manufacturing economy, sub-economy, to emerge in the United States. And I think the perspectives that the panelists here will bring to this are going to be crucial. So in particular, we're going to talk about a number of questions that we will hope to cover at the end, to some degree, at the end of the panel. And of course, we'll have it open for questions. Each of us is going to talk about 5 minutes, and then we'll have plenty of time for discussion among the panel and questions from the audience. But given the sort of framing that we've started with, I think one of the questions is, why abroad? So what is it that makes producing abroad relative to the United States advantageous? And also relatedly, what specific strategies, innovation approaches, and policies can make manufacturing technologies and employment stay in the United States? I think another sort of important question is, what are the costs for the US of the shift of employment from manufacturing to non-manufacturing that's happening both for secular and international trade and offshoring related reasons. And this also intersects with another key question, which is whether the decline in manufacturing workforce in the United States, the fact that there are fewer and fewer things that are being produced, assembled, and operated in the United States, actually is making it harder for the remaining manufacturers to be productive because the ecosystem around them is getting smaller. And that, of course, leads to the question of what characteristics of the US workforce would be necessary for the encouragement of new manufacturing innovation and the plants around them to be based in the United States and thrive there. And of course, that in turn leads to another crucial question, which is what is the niche that the United States can capture in the global economy? In other words, what are the areas in which innovation and other manufacturing activities can make the United States innovative? And here, it becomes quite crucial to think of what sort of software technologies, robotics along the lines of what Rod Brooks talked about, and other analytical technologies can actually enhance US innovativeness. And then, of course, a crucial thing for where we are sitting right now is what's the role of US academia? Is US academia just a provider of general human capital for industry, or is it also an important source of innovation that can work hand in hand with US manufacturing? And finally, I think this all is going to depend on a set of questions that I think our panel is going to address also, which is what sort of new paradigms in manufacturing are going to emerge, especially from the greater importance of networked machines and networked customers, firms, and supply chain that is evolving. That has been evolving over the last 30 or 40 years in the manufacturing and the global scale. So without further ado, I will pass it to Dave,
Thank you, Daron. I'm going to speak both as an educator and as a manufacturing researcher, and maybe say a few surprising things since most of my early career, at least, was automation, robotics, control systems, the innovative technology, if you will, that we often associate with manufacturing. But early on in my career, I got involved with then LFM, Leaders for Manufacturing, now LGO, and started to understand that really manufacturing was a much larger issue. So fast forward to now, and I've been involved in the Commission on Innovation and Production that you'll hear about in the next session, and also the Advanced Manufacturing Partnership that was put together by the Office of Science, Technology, and Policy to look at very much U.S.-centric problems. And I've heard from Daron and others about economic motivations, and we hear about other technological things, all of which I think are extremely important. But the one that I've seen the most, I guess, through my experience, seeing LFM and LGO grow, and in growing a newer program, our Master of Engineering in Manufacturing program, is the importance of the prominence of manufacturing and the passion for it by its practitioners. I think one of your questions was, why are things going offshore? Why do people go offshore? We've asked a number of speakers from industry who address our students this question, and over the years, the answer has changed. And one of the common answers now is, and I'll use my own words, is people want to do it more in other places. People will do a better job in other places. It's not strictly a matter of cost. It's a matter of aggressiveness, desire to do it, desire to learn how to do it better, those types of things. So I've become a firm believer in at least the idea that one of our central issues is how to make manufacturing, or as it's now called by the federal government, advanced manufacturing, a more prominent career, something that the best and the brightest want to excel in, and that we draw the best and brightest into. And one of the interesting things that came up during this advanced manufacturing partnership discussion, which was really only about 6 months, and there'll be some sort of a report coming out from that shortly, was the idea that it is a three-way, obviously a three-way problem, the government, industry, and the university. And one of the things that I've noticed as a difference is that when we started LGO, it was industry and the university. Very strong partnership, is still a strong partnership. Federal government was completely out of it. And that was great for all of us, except it didn't necessarily solve this fundamental national problem that I think that we have. And so by bringing in the federal government as a partner, I think we now have an opportunity. It's a very important time right now to really set some of these policies that you're talking about that may include tax policy and other sorts of economic policies. But we hope it will also be things that from industry, from the federal government, and I think most importantly, from my point of view, from universities, to really signal to the population, to the people that would like to have, that would like to do these careers, that this is a good thing to do. One of the things, again, that we've learned from our experience when we do have targeted programs on manufacturing is there's a fairly large well of very bright people in the United States who would like to do this. They just need the encouragement to do it. They need to have the incentive to do this more than something else. And I think that's a very important role that all of us can play. I think that the universities have to stay the course. One of the things that we did as part of this most recent study was kind of look around at least at MIT-like universities who have all had manufacturing programs. And to my dismay, seen a lot of them not necessarily disappear, but wilt a little bit, I guess is the best way to put it. And we really need the ability to stay the course and stay with us and not go in some ways from crisis to crisis. And likewise, this may not be news to a lot of people here, but when we started the Leaders for Manufacturing program, probably the central issue that united MIT and the partner companies was the need to attract better people to manufacturing, smarter people, people who really wanted to do this, and the companies wanted to make it a more prominent role within their organizations. And so it's actually not news. And I think if you look at around at our alums, many of whom are here, I think you can see we succeeded very well on that. The problem is propagating it nationally. So I guess my point is that we can talk a lot about a number of different things, but as I go to different countries and I look at countries, of course, like Germany and also Singapore, where I've spent a lot of time, and even in China, you see just a whole different attitude toward careers in manufacturing and toward the industry of manufacturing. The last thing I'd mention, is why now, in some ways, is some recent information that's come out about a decline in employment. That's not recent. We all know about that, decline in employment in manufacturing. But the stunning thing is when you peel back those numbers a little bit and you look at who's been losing their jobs and how it relates to their level of education, of not surprisingly, and this won't surprise anybody, that the less education you have, the steeper the decline. In fact, some data says it doesn't even come even until you have a college four-year degree. You get a slight gain in employment over the past, say, decade or so. But for advanced degrees, quite surprisingly, and don't ask me any more details about this, I'm just repeating some facts I've seen. For advanced degrees, it's been a huge increase in the number of people in the manufacturing profession. So, you know, it is a completely different animal than it was even 10, 20 years ago. And I think there's a lot of reason to sort of redouble our efforts to make it something that is more prominent for our universities, for our companies, and for the country.
Okay. Wonderful. Narendra, thank you, please.
Thank you. So I'm with Accenture, and our mission at Accenture is to make sure that our clients deliver at high performance in whatever they do. And many years ago, I was asked to lead our supply chain program at Accenture, and I took the approach of building an academic partnership with the Leaders for Manufacturing, with David Simcilevi, to look at what drives high performance among our customers and across the globe, really. We looked at 1,100 companies at that time as to what drives high performance in supply chains. We've been working together for, about a half a dozen years now, and recently also looked at a paper on manufacturing in North America, and I think David's going to talk more about that before. So this tradition of having an academic partnership is something I latched onto pretty quickly, and I'm glad to be here. But I want to pick up on a couple of things you said, David, before I get into some of my comments here. And you mentioned Singapore. I've recently been asked to make sure that Accenture builds its business and has the highest capabilities in analytics with the convergence of big data and various technologies, right, analytic insight into all parts of business, whether it's supply chain, whether it's marketing, et cetera, is making a fundamental shift in the way clients are actually using information to change the way they do business. And new business models are clearly coming up around it. As we engage in this across the globe, clearly North America is a big focus of ours, given the scale here. But there's a marked difference in how Singapore or Ireland would approach me from a federal level, from a government level, on setting up centers in making sure that we do most of our research and development in the area of analytics in those countries than here. So it talks to the interest is not only at the individual level, but it talks to the buzz, right? And the buzz that we see across the globe. Coming back to the topic at hand around manufacturing as part of a network, right? There's clearly market forces that drive that have driven a shift in manufacturing across the globe now. Demand is picking up. All new growth in demand is picking up in the Asian countries and in emerging markets like Latin America, et cetera. That gravity is just going to continue. And with that comes a shift in manufacturing and percent in manufacturing. That's always going to happen, right? That's combined with a set of strategies around outsourcing, offshoring, and the ability to deal with extended supply chains. That's continued to move manufacturing offshore, because it's been very predictable to have a supply chain network that extended. But I think both John Reed as well as Rod talked to the fact that flexibility in your supply chain is getting more and more important, right? So there are strategies now that are giving the option to pull manufacturing back onshore, right? Clearly, the cost of oil is going to be a major driver as you go along, and as oil costs increase, the ability to move more and more assembly and packaging onshore is going to be a driver that brings us forward. But this is these strategies, which definitely our clients will look at and continue to adapt, are really offset by a few areas, that supply chain challenges that are worth talking about, right? You mentioned interest in having clusters of firms or clusters of innovation. And as you see manufacturing move offshore, with it moves a lot of R&D and innovation. I've often been involved in engagements where we're helping our clients come up with the best supplier strategy and find the best suppliers across the globe to deliver advanced parts or assemblies into goods that are created in North America, and that's a very effective way of making sure that you have an innovative supply chain. You drive low cost. Cost always comes up. We've talked about it over here, but about 4 or 5 years ago, you started seeing a shift in how suppliers reacted to such requests, and the shift you saw was around the supplier looking to see what type of innovation and engineering insight they're going to get from their customers over here, right, before they sign on for long-term relationships. And saw it once, and I, attributed it to being a very sharp, long-term supplier. You see it twice, and then suddenly you see the pattern, right? And the patterns definitely come about where even if you're part of an extended supply chain, there is a real understanding among the best suppliers globally that they are looking to be part of a very innovative manufacturing network and supply chain rather than simply sign on because the largest demand is going to come from North America. That gives us something to think about, because as you continue to extend out your supply chain and move manufacturing around, which you have to, you can't lose sight of the R&D and innovation that comes from actually engineering something. Okay, so I'll stay there.
Thanks, Narendra.
Okay.
Jim is going to talk next.
Hi, my name is Jim Breen. I'm with Johnson & Johnson. For people who don't know Johnson & Johnson, we're about a $65 billion healthcare company. We have a very wide diversity of products. We have consumer products, which you may know, baby shampoo, Tylenol, Aveeno, Neutrogena. We have medical devices, which could be sutures, medical implants, and we have pharmaceuticals and biopharmaceuticals. So if you've ever heard of Remicade or Crucell vaccines or other type of pharmaceutical products, our consumer business is probably about $15 billion out of the $65 billion. And then the farm medical device are both about the same, medical device being a little bit more, but both about $25 billion. So if you can imagine, that's a wide array of making baby shampoo to making vaccines and making medical devices. So our supply chain is pretty complex. But what we tend to do is look at, you know, out of the $65 billion, over 50% of our sales is ex-US. So a lot of times in our growth of the company, we do have facilities that are overseas, or we may purchase, we purchase a lot of different companies. If you look at our model that we've used over the last years of the company, we purchase firms, and then we actually inherit facilities at that point to some of the questions about where manufacturing is located. But I think one of the things is the big thing with our company is we like to come up with new products, new novel ideas, new ways of delivery systems. And so we're constantly looking for new innovation, anywhere from our consumer business, which probably has a higher turn of new products, as opposed to pharmaceuticals, probably because of the regulatory time it takes to get something approved. It takes a little bit longer to get new products into the market there. So we're constantly looking for innovation and all that. I think, you know, with my role in J&J is I'm in charge of network management. So we look both with our internal and, like some of the panel here talked about, externals. We look for supplier innovation and look and see how we can come up with the best possible network, considering all the different factors, a lot of the factors that have been already talked about. You know, if price of fuel changes, how could that change the look of the network? As we purchase a new company, how does that change our network? Or the other thing we look a lot of times is our product life cycle. You know, as different products get into different age periods, do we look at the network in a different format? I think the other thing with the academia, the linkage with academia, I think J&J has a very, very strong linkage. We actually use a lot of people within co-ops, getting them into manufacturing early in the different plants that we have in the U.S. and all over the world. We have relationships with R&D to try to come up with new novel technologies. And I think the other thing is a lot of the companies that we purchased, I was thinking as I was sitting here, a lot of them had started up in little clusters in university cities in the U.S. and around the world. Okay, and that's just our model. It's a much more global model, looking at, you know, basically since we're over 50% outside the U.S. in sales, we look globally. I think as we go forward, also our market, in terms of our market access, there's a huge focus on penetrating markets overseas that have a higher growth rate than maybe the U.S. that would cause different actions. But overall, I think the linkage with academia in the U.S. and then just our broad portfolio of products really gives us many different parameters and factors to look at when we're looking at how we locate manufacturing around the world. Okay.
Bill, thank you.
Thank you. I think it's a great topic. As we look at manufacturing, you know, I think companies at the end of the day are trying to build competitive products. So why did we move offshore? Was to build competitive products. And there was a time where, when you looked at it, you had a deflationary period. You had high labor costs here in the U.S. You had cheap energy. And it didn't necessarily feel like you had to have a core competency to build your product. You had to have a core competency maybe in design, distribution, sales. And so, and by the way, this hasn't happened overnight. This is 50 years ago this all started happening. So people said, well, I can move it offshore. I can cut my costs. I can get rid of some of the, get out of policies or regulations that essentially make it difficult. And so, you know, we were in an environment where it didn't make sense to necessarily have it close. It didn't make sense to own it. It made sense to build competitive products in other places because your customers asked for lower prices. That's, at the end of the day, what drove it. And you felt you could get a quality. Now, it was interesting. I looked at Dr. Brooks's presentation. He gave, I thought, a fantastic presentation. He had this, why manufacture in the U.S.? And if you looked at all those things and you went back 20 years, you'd say, nobody even thought about that. Nobody said, intellectual property, I got to protect it. That wasn't on people's minds. And I think what's happened is, you know, we have this discussion now because I think of jobs in the U.S., but I think there are other disruptive factors that are actually coming into play that are going to remake what manufacturing is going to look like. Now, I wouldn't say it's going to move to the U.S. unless we ride these disruptive changes. But I think that in the end, those in those countries that choose to embrace and drive those changes are going to be the ones to actually own manufacturing going forward. And I think those are things like, you know, it was mentioned, the price of energy is going up. So you have to, I think, at the end of the day, begin to look at where and how your supply chains work, how you move things around. Because if you're in the wrong place, the cost of distribution can suddenly go very high. The cost of your supply chain can go high. I think the second thing people are going to begin to look at is that the nature of automation is, and that's what I think Dr. Brooks was getting at, the nature of automation is changing. 3D printing, robotics, automation, analytics, sensors, you name it. And you suddenly find that you can become very efficient in a variety of markets. And I think then the final thing is if you begin to look at, it used to be raw materials, rare earth materials, such as those kind of things, it used to be very cheap, but the price of these things is changing. So the engineering gets much more complex. Having your engineering near your manufacturing is important. And so at the end of the day, the ability to have a well-educated manufacturing workforce is becoming increasingly important. Cheap labor is not going to be a driving force as these changes occur. So the real question is, do you have that educated population? You know, in the U.S., the number of engineers is about 135,000 a year. We graduate. That hasn't really changed in 20 years. If we don't begin to have a different kind of educated population, I think it's going to be hard for us to catch some of those changes. So the real question is, do you have the educated population? Do you in fact have the automation, the technology you need? Do you have engineering near your manufacturing? Do you have the right supply chain automation? All of these things will open up new opportunities. And I think that's why we talk about advanced manufacturing rather than just manufacturing, because that is the future. And if we don't have the right environment to move to that, you can create all the policies you want. It's just not going to move as rapidly as you'd like.
Well, thank you very much. I think this was a very informative set of questions. Thanks, Dave. Thanks, Narendra. And thanks, Jim and Bill. So I want to say a few words, bring it back to the sort of the overarching issues. In particular, what I want to talk very briefly about is, you know, in what ways is manufacturing special, and what sort of ideas this brings for policy and strategies. A set of interesting research in economics, some by Adam Jaffe, Rebecca Henderson, and Trachtenberg, and some by a student of mine who is now at Harvard Business School, Bill Kerr. You know, they have very nicely sort of illustrated that there is a lot of stickiness, there's a lot of localness to knowledge. So when you look at, for example, citation patterns, a lot of patents are cited in the neighborhood, in the local neighborhood in which they are originally granted. If you look at who cites patents from abroad, if you have a particular set of patterns in a specific industry that is taken by Chinese researchers in the United States, those are much more likely to be cited by Chinese producers in China. And if you look at some that are taken by, say, Indian researchers in the United States, they're much more likely to be cited in India. So there are very local, very tacit pathways of knowledge. And as a result of this, you actually see that when you have large plants that are technologically advanced, the sort of advanced manufacturing plants or other sort of advanced plants that enter into a local economy, that generally does seem to create some sort of spillovers. For other plants in the same county, for example, that are in the same business or use similar technologies become more productive. And that really sort of brings other ideas about what really a high-wage economy is about. An old thesis in economics that goes back to Habakkuk and something that I've also worked on is that, you know, high wages are not only a disadvantage for companies but also encourage innovation because it really creates an inducement for firms to try to save on the expensive technology, expensive labor. So it's not really irrelevant for thinking of high living standards, but high wages are also part of a perhaps innovative economy. And this creates a range of important pathways for manufacturing to be important for the economy as a whole. Manufacturing tends to be a more high-wage, more innovative sector of the economy, but it's not. Manufacturing is not totally special. There are other sectors, you know, in services such as healthcare and education, entertainment, and energy, which are also becoming sort of important platforms or technologies. But what's really, at some level, distinguishing about manufacturing is that it's really a nexus for many of these crucial things that are taking place together. So I think it's very difficult to think of an innovative economy without a manufacturing core to it. But this still doesn't answer the question of how to sort of approach these manufacturing innovation clusters that all four of the panelists have hinted about. And at some level, you know, I think one can think of various different sort of approaches to it. You know, simplifying it a little bit, you can think of a sort of an Apple strategy. So the Apple strategies that design and value added are very much in the United States, but assembly and production aren't. So if you look at, you know, there's a very interesting study from University of California, Irvine. So they've looked at how, you know, a video iPod is produced and where the different parts of it come from. Almost the entire sort of manufacturing globe is used in producing an iPod of this sort. You know, Taiwan, Korea, China, Japan, and different kind of elements come from different parts of it. Some of them are designed in different parts and manufacturing in different parts of the world. But still, the important point is that if you take the retail and distribution into account, the vast majority of the value added is still in the United States. So the Apple model is not a total failure for the United States. So for instance, the numbers that they come up with is that out of $190 value added, over $155 is in the United States. Less than $30 is all across all of these South Korea, Taiwan, China, Japan. But of course, an alternative is sort of the German model or the Heartland model that Rod Brooks was talking about, where a lot more of the production is done locally, and that might actually create a lot more spillovers because production and R&D perhaps can feed off each other. That's one area where, you know, I've already covered some of the some of the empirical evidence that economists and other scholars have sort of brought, but this sort of complementarity hasn't fully been understood. But I think it's also important to sort of be specific about what we don't want. So what we don't want is a reversal, is a wholesale reversal of the technological trends, including the offshoring and the outsourcing and the international competition that's been happening. You know, a lot of the offshoring that took place in the early stage was taking not the high wage, not the advanced manufacturing, but the lower phase manufacturing into other countries. Now that has important implications for inequality, in particular along the lines of the issues that Dave raised about where manufacturing jobs are being created, but also competition is very valuable. Another interesting research that's been done by Nicholas Bloom, Draca, and John Van Rienen shows that when you look at specific industries, narrow industries which have been more and more exposed to Chinese competition in manufacturing, you see indeed declines in employment in those sectors, and declines in production in the United States, but this is also accompanied by a much larger increase in patenting, R&D, and productivity growth. So there is a sense in which competition is holding us to a higher standard. It's like a Red Queen effect. We have to run faster in order to stand where we are, but that running faster is valuable both for the world and for the U.S. economy. So what this actually brings us to sort of corporate and policy strategies for making better use of manufacturing manufacturing. And I think there are some important issues here. And as again, the panel has indicated, you know, the only reason why companies go abroad is not lower labor costs. There is also important tax policy reasons, and there are other regulation reasons that actually encourage companies. I think the tax policy here is very important. I'll come back to the numbers in 1 second because I want to put them in contrast to R&D numbers, but deferral of foreign earned taxes is actually not a trivial amount. Transport costs create important cost advantages or disadvantages. But this is not only transport across countries, but also within the United States. So the United States infrastructure is very important because, you know, the competition to shipping things from abroad is shipping things at home. But that's not cheap either. So that's where infrastructure is going to become important. Education is obviously a very important input, not only because of the general human capital that we supply to these to manufacturers, but as Dave also noted, if you look at where manufacturing employment is coming from, it's coming from college graduates or people with advanced degrees. But here, again, the United States has a very peculiar picture. If you look at the U.S. College completion rates, so what fraction of the U.S. population has college degrees, you know, that's peaked in 1969. We've never reached that level in the last 32 years. So we're still below, for males, the 1969 level. For both sexes combined, we've just reached the 1969 level, or perhaps exceeded it a little bit. So the academic support to it will not only come from creating innovations in our universities, which we are quite good at, perhaps not so good at the partnership with companies, but creating innovations in universities we're very good at. But the U.S. as a whole is not supporting industry manufacturing enough by creating enough sufficient number of college graduates. And the other aspect of the policy is what sort of support do we provide overall to R&D. So United States became a leader in R&D, both in the amount of R&D and the quality of R&D long before the 2000s. But in fact, the last 30 years have seen a decline in this, not only because other countries have become much more aggressive in their R&Ds. And again, Rod mentioned what's going on in some of the countries around Europe, and we know about Japan and China, but also because of the support that we provide for R&D. United States was also an innovator in, for example, providing R&D tax credit and other sorts of supports, both coming from academia and just from the for corporate R&D. But we've been sort of slipping there. United States was the was by far the leader in how generous it was in supporting R&D about 30 years ago. Today we are number 24 in terms of how generous among the world our R&D is. And I said I'll come back to the tax numbers. So according to the government's own numbers, is that the amount of tax deferrals for foreign earned profits for U.S. companies costs about $40 billion. The entire R&D that goes to corporate sector as support is $10 billion. So when you look at, you know, how we actually, what sort of incentives the U.S. policy gives to U.S. companies, you know, we see the $40 billion versus $10 billion as an important element. And then the final thing I want to sort of mention here is that we also need to think of the support that R&D, manufacturing, and innovation receive much more holistically. And that's sort of the topic that I've worked on, is the sort of interaction between economics and politics. And again, coming back to the sorts of issues that all four of the panelists have raised, you know, the businesses, and especially R&D type businesses that are not only innovative but also require long-term planning, require some sort of stability and the right sort of regulations, and that requires the right sort of political infrastructure. And there are concerns about what's going on with that political infrastructure in the United States. So at some level, both at the corporate level and at the U.S. policy level, there is a lot of slack that can be easily filled for making the United States much more innovation-friendly, and then the innovation with the corporate strategies and the network that companies are developing will take best use of which sort of ways of organizing that innovation with the production both at home and abroad, perhaps. So here, I think I'll stop and see whether there are some follow-up comments and then questions from the audience.
Well, I wanted to pick up on the Apple model. It's often cited, and actually we have a good number of MIT alums at Apple in a number of positions. And we always say, well, Apple doesn't have any manufacturing. They actually have a huge manufacturing staff, and they hire many of our engineering students as well as LGO and MBA students. And I would actually say it's an interesting case, using my earlier words. I think they're very passionate about manufacturing. Their particular model is that they will partner with those who actually own the manufacturing asset. I'm not sure how replicable the model is. But I think we don't want to lose the fact that they, I was thinking about this the other day. In some ways, the difference between the early iMac and the current iMac, you could say, is manufacturing. The guts aren't that much different. They've slowly followed Moore's law. But the beautiful exterior that we love so much, was really a manufacturing tour de force. The earlier ones were sort of a design, the bright colors were cute and all that, but the later ones are really a manufacturing tour de force, which has made them difficult to catch for their competitors. Again, the internals aren't that different, but the external very much is. So even at that extreme example, I think you find that the really successful companies, the ones that are really innovative, have tied it with manufacturing.
Any other?
I was thinking of the Apple example after getting your email, right, Daron, and picking up on what you and David said, even if you consider it an extreme, right, I decided to ask myself the question why. My wife and I just moved to Manhattan about a year and a half ago, so we had to replace a lot of things. We moved into an apartment because we were empty nesters. I started walking around the apartment and looking at everything that we replaced, right? You can forget the high-tech stuff. It's all Apple. Forget it, right? Then you start looking at dishwashers and fridges. And then you get down to a sink. And my wife bought a German sink. And I asked the question, why? Why do we have to buy a German sink? And why wouldn't we buy an American sink, right? And it gets down to the engineering behind the sink. Mm-hmm. So I went and asked a bunch of questions and compared the American to the German one. And someone explained that Frankie, this company, has spent 20 years in making sure that you can get that satin nickel finish, and that after use for 10 years, it'll still look like it's the same. So it doesn't matter whether you're at the high-tech component end or you're into something as fundamental as pressing and fabricating metal, right? You have a cluster of innovation around you, as what I think you call that, the Heartland model, Daron. Yeah. And it was a real eye-opener to just walk around, look at everything you've procured or purchased, and think about why it is that you picked that one, right, and where it came from. So I just thought I'd add that.
Jim?
Yeah, I would just add two things. I think your comment about infrastructure is important because, like with Johnson & Johnson, some products like Vistacon, disposable contact lenses, we deliver them next day. Other ones, we have multiple different ways of modeling of delivering these products to customers, but in other countries the infrastructure is not as reliable. So I think that is something there's a lot of talk in the press about the infrastructure. So I think that's really important. And then with the Apple model, because I always get asked about it, I think there's multiple different ways of solving these problems, and I think it really has to do with your products, what's the life cycle. But I think it's constantly evolving. I think you're just we're constantly looking at our model. Is there a better way to do it? We watch the horizons, how things go, and we follow innovation. And I think that's how these models will kind of continually change.
So I've been in Silicon Valley for the past 10 years, not worked at Apple, but at some other well-known companies. By the way, I tried to buy the mandatory blue suit. They don't sell that in the Bay Area, it turns out. So I had to buy a suit for this. It was mandatory. So the fact is, I will tell you, the companies I've been at, and Apple's no different than most of them. Nobody wakes up in the morning and says, we've got to outsource. That is not how you start. Nobody's sitting there going, I'm going to move, go to Foxconn and do it. That is not the process. It's, I got to build this product. And where is the talent and the capability at a price point to get me there? Where is the supply chain? How do I know I'm going to get this product out, and can I build the number of models? How do I make sure I don't carry the inventory, and where do I move risk? That's what you decide. And what has happened is that over the past 50 years, this has not occurred in one day, over the past 50 years, the fact is, and Dr. Brooks showed it, There's been this movement that's occurred over there where they've made investments. And so the fact is there's a huge infrastructure of capability for manufacturing over there that doesn't exist here. So unless you're willing to take a risk and build your own plants, et cetera, and by the way, GE is doing that, we're moving that, you've got to have the capital and then you've got to have the policies and everything else to make it work. And you cannot do it, you can't look in the rearview mirror. That's not how manufacturing is done anymore. You've got to look for all new manufacturing business models that start to begin to automate those processes. It can be done, by the way. And I think that the good news, and if you'll go to the Bay Area, a lot of people working on technologies that are totally trying to disrupt this to allow it to be done at lower price points. And so the fact is, if we could lower the cost of a lot of the processes and the management of this, if you can use analytics to get deeper insight into it so that you can adjust your processes, then having it closer has a huge benefit to what you're doing. And Apple's a great model, I think, because quite honestly, if you go back, Apple always wanted to do manufacturing locally. And it was moved, you know, I think, because finally they just couldn't continue to live with the economics of the situation. There's a company that did a lot, built their own factories. In fact, they were well known for how they designed their factories. So I think the fact is that you got to realize nobody wakes up in the morning and says, I'm moving it over there. You know, that's my policy. It's what do I do to get the product I need at the right price point distributed? So unless the model changes, unless the capabilities are built in, unless we get the engineers that are necessary closer to manufacturing, which is a huge benefit, nothing's going to change. And I think that's the key, is how do we enable an environment? How do we get people innovating technology? How do we take it out of the universities and put it into practice? Because until you do that, that's not, we don't have a recipe yet for making this kind of shift.
I think that's, that is very important, the lesson that's kind of comes from here. I think, both from an economic point of view and from the practitioner's point of view, it's natural that companies are going to have a strong incentive to do whatever is cost effective and whatever maximizes the quality. I think, you know, the enabling institutions and the enabling policies and the environment has to be there if we want that manufacturing to be more innovative as it has been, and even more innovative, and also a lot more of its components to be at home. So I think that's where some of the sort of underlying infrastructure, academic and other background is relevant. So I think we have about 10 minutes for taking questions from the audience. And if you can wait for the microphone, and then also if you want to direct it to a specific member of the panel, please do so. Yes, please.
So this question is for Bill and Narendra. Assuming that big data takes off in manufacturing, which I think you both expect it will, is that good news or bad news for the U.S. From a workforce standpoint and a location of manufacturing standpoint?
My take is big data has to take off to really enable it here. I think that this is going to be one of three key technologies to give us an edge. And I think it's interesting. I really dislike the term big data, because when I go talk to customers, I'm sure you hear the same thing. They all go, I got lots of data. I don't know what it means. So we don't want a big data problem. We actually got a big insight problem. Now, what I see is the innovation, and if you go start looking where VCs are putting money, they're putting money into companies to do insight into a lot of areas. You know, I saw one in agriculture. They have sensors. They look at the dirt, and then they help you really figure out how to maximize in terms of the fertilizer, the watering, and everything else that goes on. So if we apply that to manufacturing, I think that can be game-changing. And I think also then we can specialize small lots. We can begin to do things that you can't do in those kind of countries. That's what people want. So I think this is where our technology edge right now, and hopefully we're going to continue to be a leader in building big insight on big data.
Yeah, just to pick up on what Bill said, I think this gives us an opening. Right, what we do with it is up to us. But the combination of insight-driven analytics with new manufacturing technologies, as well as you know, the nudge that's going to come, right? It's a matter of when, as Dr. Brooks put it, as to when stuff like oil prices and energy prices starts moving the pendulum in one area. But it comes down to what we do with it, right? And whether we will pick up on some of these initiatives and partnerships. I'm just starting. I've been asked to drive insight-driven everything at Accenture for the last half year. And as I mentioned earlier, we're setting up centers across the globe. I didn't have to go selling Ireland and Singapore on setting up a center there, right? They came to me. I mean, they wouldn't let me rest until I had a discussion with the government in Singapore, with the government in Ireland, and what they could do to help us make sure that we are creating either EU-based or Asia-based insight centers there. It's just a fundamental difference in the gravity pull that you feel. And we've got to start behaving the same way if we're going to take advantage of the flexibility that insight and a bunch of technologies that are coming together will allow us to make. So that's kind of where we are.
Hi, thank you. A recent policy change here in the U.S. was the shift from a first-to-invent to a first-to-file patent system. And one of the cited reasons for that was that it makes us a little more compatible with international regimes. But there was several persons, notably a few senators, who argued vehemently that it was counterproductive for making the U.S. more innovation-friendly. And then, of course, there's a third camp that thinks the whole thing needs to be rethought and micro-patent kind of ideas introduced. So I think it's pretty relevant when you talk about innovation in manufacturing. So I'd be curious to hear your thoughts on that.
Well, I would just say intellectual property and innovation are extraordinarily important to manufacturing and supply chain, right? I think that is going to be the future. You know, certainly if you look at this change in approach, we're moving to a global economy, so aligning to the rest of the world makes certain things a lot easier. I think though, however, I'm sure right now we don't know the unintended consequences to this, and as we figure these out, I think we're gonna end up, we'll see further shifts in this in the future because I think what we have to do is maintain an innovation edge. I think one thing that would be unfortunate is if we didn't pay attention to enabling innovation. If this turns out, as some people are worried, to pull innovation back, that would be a huge problem. So I think it's very important for us to make sure that we're, as you point out, watching what this does to innovation and be prepared to change quickly. Are we? That would be the area I would be concerned about. And I think nobody knows, at least I believe no one knows the answer as to what this is going to mean.
If I can just add, I mean, I think, you know, the patent system, intellectual property rights, has been absolutely the bulwark of innovation for the last 300 years. But there is a real question as to whether, as the nature of technologies and the nature of the networks that firms form in using technologies has changed, whether the current patent system that we have is actually serving us. And I think there are real questions that there are real question marks there. There are all these scare stories about ideas that go back 50 years being patented and creating costs for companies, creating unnecessary litigation, all the patent thickets. And we have one of the most dynamic industries in the United States, in the world at the moment. The mobile phone industry, for example, has been totally taken over by patent wars, and companies are being bought and sold because of their patent chest. So that really raises questions about fundamental reforms that are necessary in patents, and that's where again the politics and the institutional underpinnings are very important, because there are big entrenched interests that don't want these patent systems to change from what they are. And I think the ones that you're mentioning raise questions about whether they're actually better, and they're very, very marginal changes. The complicating the story is exactly the sort of unintended consequences that Bill mentioned, which is that I think we really don't know what an optimally flexible patent system that's right for the software age, for the robotics age, for the nanotechnology age, and for the international age that we live, where international protection of intellectual property internationally is a very tough thing also. What that sort of optimal patent system would look like, I think, is not something that we know. I think we sort of need to go there in small steps, but at the moment, I don't see that the directions that we're going as very constructive in that. Yes, please.
Thank you. My name's Tricia Moody, and I publish a magazine online called Blue Heron Journal. I'm a manufacturing geek, and it's a family obsession. So I want to ask a question, an ugly question, about the elephant in the room, which is we've unplugged our computers. I go see factories every week. They have been working really hard on lean manufacturing. That's probably the first time I've heard that phrase used this morning, which is good. But it's part of the infrastructure problem that we're all approaching, and I kind of want to know what you all think about that and what you think will happen to plug the computers back in again. I mean, I see problems with bill of material structures that have just rusted away and fallen apart, and people who don't know what MRP is and who aren't accustomed to using it. And I think it's because we've been working on lean for so long. I'd like to just, you know, hear ideas about what we might do to reverse that trend. Thank you.
I guess speaking for GE, I mean, we've just built some new appliance factories. I can say these are as automated. We're not unplugging. I mean everything there, these are as automated a factory as you're going to see. I think it's interesting to hear you say that, because I don't see us unplugging. What I actually see is quite the opposite effect, is that we're looking for more and more automation. And, you know, I would say that you can't separate the manufacturing out from design, from distribution and operations anymore. I think these things all become one continuum. The reason I mention that is if you don't collect the information in manufacturing and you don't provide the information you did in design into manufacturing, and you don't take that and apply it into the distribution and back to the end user and collect the information from the end user and put it back into manufacturing, I don't think you can get as efficient as you need to be. So from our perspective, everything from how you design is changing to become more automated. We're working on advanced crowdsourcing with some DARPA, how to design vehicles using crowdsourcing. And then you take that information, you plug that into how you rethink manufacturing, and you manufacture. So design takes manufacturing into account. How you set up the lines is done in design, not separate. This is the change that is occurring. And I'm just going to say it's you know, what's happening in sort of the consumer world, in upsetting all these consumer businesses and rethinking how we distribute music and books. We have the opportunity in manufacturing to do it. And if you're unplugging the computers, you ain't going to get there. And you can pretend that you're going to still sell books the old way, but it you're going to lose because you didn't do it the new way. And I believe that innovation is at the heart of the future.
I think we have to call it a day. I would like to thank Dave Hardt, Narendra Mulani, Jim Breen, and Bill Rue. That's been a very instructive session. Thank you.
Thank you.